Blackstone Publishing presents The Spirit Photographer, a novel by John Michael Varese. This book is read by Lloyd James. For Jacques de Spoulbert. Author's note. This work of fiction is inspired by events that took place during the spiritualist movement in 19th century America. While some of the story is based on the life of William Mumler, the first American spirit photographer, and other historical figures, it makes no claims to accuracy with regard to characters, places, or events. If I do not remember thee, let my tongue cleave to the roof of my mouth. Psalm 137, verse 6. Book 1. Reunion. Banner of Light, Boston, Massachusetts, Saturday, August 5th, 1865. A new phase of spiritual manifestations is exciting a great deal of attention and wonder in those who take an interest in the grand and beautiful subject of spirit communion. If this phenomenon in spiritual manifestation be genuine, it is the greatest and the best yet given to outside perception, and bears incontrovertible evidence of the truth that spiritual communications are what they claim to be, namely, actual manifestations of the dead to the living. Mr. Edward Moody is the medium and the artist who makes photographs of spirits. His business has lately been ornamental engraving, a very profitable business which he says has paid him upwards of $9 a week, but, from causes he cannot explain, he is being forced to leave it and engage in photography, which art he practiced under the employment of Mr. Matthew Brady in the years before and during the war. Mr. Moody is not a spiritualist, nor, he says, has he ever believed in spiritualism, but on the contrary, has opposed and ridiculed it. He has many times been told by mediums that he was a very powerful and peculiar medium. This he did not believe, and only laughed at the communications. A few Sundays since, he being alone with Mrs. Lovejoy in her photograph saloon above her silver goods store at 258 Washington Street, he produced a picture of Mrs. Lovejoy which, to his great astonishment and wonder, revealed not just the sitter on the developed plate, but also a picture of a young woman standing by the sitter's side. While looking upon the strange phenomenon, the picture of two persons upon the plate instead of one, the thought and the conviction flashed upon his mind, "This is the picture of a spirit." And in it, Mrs. Lovejoy recognized the likeness of her deceased cousin, which is also said to be correct by others who have seen the picture and who knew her. Mr. Moody related this wonderful experience to some persons who were interested in spiritualism, and they at once eagerly sought to have the experiment tried upon themselves, the result of which has been that some 10 or more persons have now had their pictures taken, and the picture of one or more spirits has been upon the same plate. Many of them have been recognized as friends that once lived on earth. The picture of the spirit is fainter and less distinct than that of the one who sits. The pictures of the spirits are not alike, each one being extraordinary and different. Chapter 1. On the day before Senator Garrett's departure for Boston, news of impending storms had disrupted the city, and so by the time his brougham began climbing up Pinckney Street toward Lewisburg Square, nearly all of the windows on Beacon Hill had already been locked and shuttered. Up ahead on the corner of Pinckney and West Cedar, Garrett spied two lone figures, their hands firm on the brims of their hats. It was old Dovehouse conversing with the new choirmaster from King's Chapel. The carriage approached, its wheels rattling in the street.
"Back again, old boy."
"I am, sir,"
Garrett replied.
"Good to have you. Congratulations on your victories. I never doubted them for a second."
The senator returned a nod. Duffhouse never doubted anything, a characteristic that had been amusing Garrett for close to 40 years. The victories to which old Duffhouse referred were the many Republican triumphs from the previous congressional session. The ratification of the 15th Amendment, giving freed men the right to vote. The passage of the First Enforcement Act, empowering the federal government to prosecute the Klan directly. And the election of Hiram Revels, a black Mississippi minister, to Jefferson Davis's old seat in the Senate chamber, a change unimaginable 20 years earlier, when Senator James B. Garrett, at the age of 39, had begun his career as a statesman.
"I suppose we can move on with things now,"
Dovehouse called out as the senator's carriage continued up the street. Garrett offered no reply. With the readmission of Georgia, the last of the outcast Confederate states, back into the Union, there were those, like Dovehouse, who had emphatically declared the country reunited, but Garrett had no intention of moving on, at least not until he had secured fundamental rights for all the country's citizens. When the senator at last arrived at his house, it, too, was dark and motionless, except for the swirling clusters of maple leaves in front of it. The house glared at him as if it were displeased with his lateness, and its unblinking frown gave him no comfort. When the front door opened and Garrett descended from the carriage, a sudden gust of wind scattered the leaves from his path.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.